Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and the page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and the timestamping for the benefit of mobile phone viewers is also been provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. This news article talks about the preparation and the dry run or the rehearsal of the lander and robotic rover of the much expected second lunar mission of India and the first mission of ISRO of landing in any celestial body. The parts of both prelim syllabus and main syllabus in which the analysis of this news article is marked in the display here. We have been reading a lot of news related to ISRO's mission of Chandrayaan 2. But the news that has appeared in today's newspaper has certain new elements in it. We know that Chandrayaan 2 is ISRO's second mission to Moon. And it is the first mission of ISRO to demonstrate soft landing on any celestial body. As we know, Chandra means Moon, Yaan means vehicle. So Chandrayaan means space vehicle to Moon. And Chandrayaan 2 means India's second mission to Moon. The article says that in this mission, there are four components. They are the launch vehicle, which is Geosynchronous Satellite Launch Vehicle, Mark 3. Then the orbiter, then the lander, which is named as Vikram, and the robotic rover, which is named as Pragyan. This robotic rover works by artificial intelligence and by using solar power. So the name of the lander is Vikram, and the sensor system in this lander is called as Hazard Detection and Avoidance System. Now, this system is critical part of this mission because these sensors should read the terrain and should find the right landing spot on the moon. So the success of the soft landing mission depends on two things. One, the sensors should correctly guide the lander to a safe site. And secondly, the fuel in the lander should not drain till the soft landing at the safe site. So if the soft landing happens as planned, India will be the fourth country in the world to demonstrate soft landing on Moon after United States, USSR and China. And after the landing on Moon, a robotic rover will come out of the lander and will move around half a kilometer for 14 Earth days. In lunar terms, it will move over the surface of the Moon for one lunar day. The news article states that the life of the robotic rover is just one lunar day, which is equivalent to 14 Earth days. And with respect to the orbiter, the expected mission life is 1 year. On 10th July, we saw that the full rehearsal for the mission was conducted in the Satish Dhawan Space Center in Sriharikota in Andhra Pradesh. Today's news article has some special information with respect to the facilities to test the landing and the roving. You know that ISRO's satellite integration and test establishment is in Bengaluru in Karnataka. As the name suggests, it takes care of the assembly, integration and testing of all communication and navigation spacecrafts. And Bengaluru is also the headquarters of ISRO. Even before 10 years, the ISRO had been creating a lunar terrain testing facility in ISRO's satellite integration and test establishment in Bengaluru. For creating the lunar terrain, it required lunar soil, or the soil from Moon with all its features, texture, lunar temperature, low gravity and same amount of sunlight as on the Moon. The lunar terrain test facility is important because in Chandrayaan 2, ISRO is going to demonstrate soft landing of its lander on the terrain of Moon. And also, a robotic rover has to move on the surface of the Moon. Moon is known for weak gravity in comparison with Earth. It is estimated that the gravity in Moon is just 16.5% of the gravity in Earth. That is, Moon's gravity is 1/6 of Earth's gravity. To create the lunar terrain, an option was available that was at high cost of about $150 for 1 kilogram of simulated lunar soil from the United States. In present exchange rate, it comes around ₹10,000 for 1 kilogram of simulated lunar soil from US. When we say simulated lunar soil, it means the soil that is prepared to have almost same properties of the lunar soil, that is soil from the moon. This option was costly and the requirement was around some 60 to 70 tons of soil. The article says that the UR Rao Satellite Center, which was earlier called as ISRO Satellite Center, has actually bought a small amount of simulated lunar soil from the United States, but a much cheaper option was actually explored by the scientists. There is a certain type of rock called as anorthosite rock. It is known that this type of rock matches with the lunar soil in terms of composition and features. But where this rock is found so that it can be transported to the lunar terrain test facility? The geologists have reported that this type of anorthosite rock was found in few sites near Salem in the state of Tamil Nadu. If we take anorthositic rock, we can find plagioclase as the dominant mineral. It is said that they are plutonic rocks with over 90% of plagioclase. When we say plagioclase, it is the name of a group of feldspar minerals that form a solid solution series ranging from pure albite to pure anorthite. Plutonic rocks are igneous rocks that is solidified by melting at a great depth. Many soil samples brought back from moon by space missions of other countries have significant plagioclase content. That is one of the reasons why anorthosite rocks are used for terrain testing of moon. This project therefore has saved ISRO almost some 45 crore rupees, because had they imported simulated lunar soil from United States, it would have cost around 70 crores. But now with the indigenous resource, the project was completed almost within some 25 crore rupees. The news article says that these challenges were not there when ISRO was carrying out its first mission to moon. Now, this is because the first mission to moon was an orbiter mission. But Chandrayaan 2 is orbiter, lander and rover mission. Using the anorthosite rock, the lunar terrain test facility was developed according to the requirements to simulate the lunar terrain, and a full rehearsal for landing and roving has been conducted recently. And the news article also says that while carrying out the test run for the rover's weight was artificially reduced to simulate conditions on moon by using helium balloons. Helium-filled balloons actually float on the air, and by connecting with rover, the weight of the rover is reduced. Helium is used for this purpose because helium balloons can actually float, and that is because of its property that helium is lighter than air. If you take the first mission to moon, the Chandrayaan 1, its data showed evidence for water in the exosphere of moon and on the surface of moon and also in the subsurface to the level of depth of 10 meters in moon. But Chandrayaan 2 is expected to help in arriving at firmest conclusions on distribution of water on moon surface and also at subsurface level as well. Then the article says the Vikram, the lander, would be the first ever spacecraft in the world to land at the lunar south pole. Now the meaning is, no country has ever landed at the site closer to lunar south pole where India has planned to soft land the lander. Two craters were planned as landing site options. They are Manzanares C and Simpelius N. So if India becomes successful in Chandrayaan 2, then it would be the country that has landed closer to lunar south pole than any other country in the world. So the landing tests were actually carried out in large test bed created in a new R&D campus or research and development campus of ISRO located in Chellakere Science City in Karnataka. The Chellakere Science City is at a distance of some 400 km from Bengaluru. More news updates we may see on July 16 after the launch of Chandrayaan 2 on July 15 in the early hours. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to next news article. This news article is about anthrax. The analysis of this news article becomes part of the underlined areas as shown here in both prelims and main syllabus. The news article states that two persons were admitted to a hospital with symptoms of cutaneous anthrax
and they have been tested positive for the disease. When we say that some persons are tested positive for some disease, it means that they are infected by the particular disease. If they are saying that they have been tested negative, it means the persons are not infected by the particular disease after the test. These persons were from Madagada village in the Araku Valley of Visakhapatnam district of Andhra Pradesh. And the article says that they bought some meat from a weekly shandy. So when they say weekly shandy, it means a weekly local market. And they have cut the meat, and that is the cause for the disease. That is what the article is saying. And officials are saying that after consuming such meat, there are chances for developing or contracting gastrointestinal anthrax. But the persons are not affected by gastrointestinal anthrax. That did not happen in this particular incident. Now, this is because, according to the officials, the spores of the disease might have been killed due to high cooking temperature. When the persons have consumed after cooking, the spores of the anthrax disease in the meat might have been killed due to high cooking temperature. When we say spore, it is a minute one-celled reproductive unit that can give rise to a new individual organism without sexual fusion. This characteristic can be seen in fungi and also in protozoans. So we'll see about this cutaneous anthrax and gastrointestinal anthrax in our analysis subsequently. The officials have also said that this disease can spread even when a dead animal is left on the ground without proper cremation, and that area particularly is likely to get affected by anthrax. And then if grass grows in that particular area, and if some animals feed on those grasses, then those animals are also vulnerable to anthrax. If a farmer cultivates a field on the same grass, then the farmer is also likely to contract or likely to develop this cutaneous anthrax through his legs. So what is this anthrax? It is an infectious zoonotic disease. That is, it can be transferred from animals to humans. It is caused by a bacterium called as Bacillus anthracis. According to WHO, it is a disease that has existed for hundreds of years, and it still naturally occurs in both animals and humans in many parts of the world. Cases of related to anthrax have been reported from Asia, Southern Europe, Sub-Saharan Africa, and even also from parts of Australia. Sahel is a semi-arid region of Western and North Central Africa that extends from Senegal to Sudan. Anthrax is also called as malignant pustule, malignant edema, wool sorter's disease, or some documents also call them as rag picker's disease. This anthrax bacteria, Bacillus anthracis, can survive in the environment by forming spores. See, as we saw earlier, a spore is a minute one-celled reproductive unit that is capable of giving rise to new individual organism without sexual fusion. If you see the most common natural form of anthrax, it creates dark sores on the skin. And that is one of the reasons why it has been named as anthrax. Because in Greek, anthrax means coal. So coal appears darker in color. And because the sores caused by Bacillus anthracis is also darker in color, they called this disease as anthrax. It is primarily a disease of herbivorous mammal, but other mammals and some birds also have been known to contract this particular disease. And anthrax was a major fatal disease in cattle, sheep, goats, camels, horses, and even in pigs, particularly before the introduction and widespread adoption of effective veterinary vaccines. These incidents of fatal deaths in cattle, sheep and goats have been seen all around the world before the widespread adoption of veterinary vaccines. And it is said that even now anthrax continues to be reported from many countries, as we saw just now. It is reported particularly in domesticated and wild herbivores. And they are saying that most of the incidents are reported from places where the livestock vaccination programs are not enough or inadequate, or where such programs are discontinued or disrupted. If we consider human beings, they generally acquire this disease directly or indirectly from infected animals, or even due to occupational or work-related exposure to the infected or contaminated animal products. So this occupational exposure to the infected animal products is the cause for the disease that was reported in the Araku Valley Mandal of Andhra Pradesh. This disease is generally regarded as non-contagious. When we say non-contagious, it means whether the disease can spread from one person to another person or from one organism to another organism by direct contact. So we can say that this generally it is non-contagious. That is, it does not spread from one person to another person. It does not spread from one organism to another organism by direct contact. But there are some records and some research studies which say that there are rare instances of person to person spread also can be seen. So, as the news article states, there are three types of anthrax in human beings. One is cutaneous anthrax or skin anthrax. Cutaneous means relating to skin or affecting the skin. That is why it is also known as skin anthrax. Of the three types of anthrax in human beings, this is the most common form. And this type has been reported in today's news in the affected persons. It is usually contracted or it is usually developed when a person has some kind of break in their skin or has a cut or abrasion in their skin. When such a person comes into direct contact with anthrax spores, he or she may be infected by this bacillus anthracis. This results in itchy bump that rapidly develops into black sore or a dark sore. And after this infection, some people may develop headaches, muscle aches or muscle pain, fever and vomiting. And it is said that this cutaneous anthrax must be treated quickly. Next, we'll see gastrointestinal anthrax. See, it is developed from eating meat from an infected animal. It causes some initial symptoms which are similar to food poisoning. But they say that these symptoms can actually worsen to produce severe abdominal pain, vomiting of blood and severe diarrhea. These are the symptoms associated with gastrointestinal anthrax. We saw that cutaneous anthrax is the most common form of anthrax in human beings. Next, we are going to see pulmonary anthrax or anthrax by inhalation. And it is the most severe form of human anthrax. This pulmonary anthrax is the rarest form of human anthrax. And this form of the disease is caused when a person is directly exposed to a large number of anthrax spores that are suspended in the air, and when the person breathes them in, he or she is infected. The first symptoms of pulmonary anthrax are similar to those of a common cold, but these symptoms can rapidly progress to severe breathing difficulties and even shock. So what can be done to prevent or to treat it? According to WHO, control in livestock is the important key to reduce the incidence of getting exposure from the livestock. And they say that anthrax responds well to antibiotic treatment. So antibiotics must be prescribed and taken with medical advice. They also say that there is a vaccine against this anthrax, but it is not approved for widespread use because it has never been comprehensively tested in human trials. This vaccine is sometimes given to people who are likely to be exposed to anthrax through their occupation or work nature, particularly those persons who work as tannery workers. When we say tannery workers, these are the persons who work in the place where animal skins are processed. And the vaccine is sometimes even given to military personnel as well. But note that this vaccine is not widely available and it is also not recommended for mass immunization. When we say mass immunization, means the process of providing immunization to a large number of people. Then this anthrax is considered as an important biological warfare agent. Usually we kill enemies by using weapons, but here they are using this anthrax as a biological agent to kill the enemies. And this is because when it is transmitted through air, through inhalation, it is highly fatal. That is, it can lead to death. And when it is released through air, enemy country may release anthrax spores to the enemy territory, where the spores can remain viable or it can survive for several decades. And these spores can be easily produced in large quantities at a very low cost. And they also say that it is easy to weaponize anthrax, and anthrax can be easily be disseminated as a odorless and invisible aerosol. So the enemy territory may not identify because it is invisible. When we say aerosol, it is a substance that can be enclosed under pressure and that can be released as a fine spray by means of some propellant gas. Thus, this weaponized aerosol can affect thousands of people at the same time. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the decision related to a petition by the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. The analysis of this news article will be relevant under the underlined portions as shown here with respect to the prelims and the main syllabus. Recently, on 4th of July, we have discussed an editorial titled as The Primacy of the Elected. The author in that editorial has actually called the Supreme Court to uphold the verdict given by the Madras High Court in regards to the tussle or the turf war between the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry and the Chief Minister of Puducherry. That is, the author asked the Supreme Court to ensure that the Lieutenant Governor should act only on the aid and advice of the elected government in Puducherry. Earlier, the Madras High Court has asked the Lieutenant Governor to act in accordance with the aid and advice of the elected government in Puducherry. It also asked the Lieutenant Governor not to interfere in the day-to-day administration of the Union Territory. Also, the legislative body of the Union Territory of Puducherry enjoys similar power of the legislative assembly of a state, though Puducherry is a Union Territory. The decision taken by the Council of Ministers and the Chief Minister is binding on the secretaries and other officials. And the Madras High Court actually rebuked the central government and the administrator of the Union Territory, who is the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry, to be true to the concept of democratic principles. So this judgment of Madras High Court was given by a single judge bench. After the judgment by the single judge of the Madras High Court, the matter was appealed to the Supreme Court. In an interim order, the Supreme Court has asked the Puducherry cabinet not to take any important decisions till the next hearing. But during the yesterday's hearing, the Supreme Court has disposed the petition filed by the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. It asked the petitioner to first move to the divisional bench of the Madras High Court if they want to appeal against the order of single judge bench of High Court of Madras. This very disposal of the petition of the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry is considered as a victory for the elected government of Puducherry. Now, this disposal means that till any new judgment, the administrator of Puducherry, who is the Lieutenant Governor, shall be bound by the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers, and the Lieutenant Governor can only refer a bill to the President and cannot reject any bill. This is based on the judgment given by the Madras High Court. If the Lieutenant Governor has a difference of opinion, then she can have deliberations with Council of Ministers, but she is expected not to interfere with any legitimate and warranted policy decision of the Council of Ministers after the deliberation. That is, after the deliberation, if a legitimate and warranted policy decision is taken by the Council of Ministers, the Lieutenant Governor should not interfere. The Madras High Court also clarified that the legislature of the Union Territory of Puducherry has supremacy over the Lieutenant Governor of Puducherry. This is because there is no restriction to the legislature of Puducherry as the National Capital Territory of Delhi. The news article talks about two articles from the Indian Constitution. They are Article 239 Capital A and Article 239 Capital A Capital A. The Article 239 AA deals with the scope and limits of the powers of the Legislative Assembly and the Council of Ministers of the Union Territory of Delhi. That is the National Capital Territory of Delhi. This article restricts the Legislative Assembly of Delhi from enacting laws in subjects of police, public order and land. That is, the legislature of Union Territory of National Capital Territory of Delhi cannot enact laws in the subjects of police, public order and land. Next, let's see Article 239, Capital A. It deals with the creation of local legislatures or Council of Ministers, or both legislatures and Council of Ministers for certain Union Territories. This article enables the Parliament to enact a law to create legislature and Council of Ministers for the Union Territory of Puducherry. But nowhere this Article 239A restricts the legislature of Puducherry from enacting law in any specific subjects. There is no restriction for the legislature of Union Territory of Puducherry. And therefore, the legislature of Puducherry Union Territory is having broad and wider powers while comparing with the legislature of NCT Delhi. We will have more updates when the petitioner moves to the divisional bench in the Madras High Court. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Now let's take the analysis of next news article. This news article is about the UN resolution with respect to sexual orientation and gender identity. The relevant portions of syllabus in prelims and mains are herewith underlined with respect to the analysis of this news article. The news article talks about a UN resolution, and this resolution was on the protection against violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. Now, know that the resolutions of the United Nations are formal expressions of the opinion or the will of the UN organs. Now, this particular resolution was the resolution of Human Rights Council of United Nations. The Human Rights Council is an intergovernmental body within the United Nations system. It is made up of 47 UN member states, in which India is also included. These states are responsible for the promotion and protection of all human rights around the globe. Also know that the Human Rights Council replaced the former United Nations Commission on Human Rights. This resolution states that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and in rights. And it reaffirms that everyone is entitled to all the rights and all the freedoms assigned in UDHR 1948, or the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And these rights and freedoms should be without any distinction of any kind, such as race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, or with respect to property or birth or any other status. It is under this resolution the Human Rights Council of UN has decided to appoint an independent expert on protection against violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity. This appointment of independent expert is for a period of 3 years. The independent expert has been mandated or given authority to act through the Human Rights Council Resolution 32/2. Now, the mandate is to assess the implementation of existing international human rights instruments. Now, this has to be carried out with attention to the ways to overcome the violence and discrimination on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity. The next task of the independent expert is to raise awareness of violence and discrimination against persons on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity, and then also to identify and address the root causes of such violence and discrimination. The independent expert has to engage in dialogue and has also should consult with the member countries and states and other relevant stakeholders. Now, these stakeholders include UN agencies, programs and funds, regional human rights mechanisms, national human rights institutions. For India, it is National Human Rights Commission, and civil society organizations, and even academic institutions. And the independent expert has been asked to work in cooperation with states, and this is to encourage the implementation of measures that contribute to the protection of all persons against violence and discrimination that are based on sexual orientation and gender identity. And the independent expert has to conduct, facilitate, and support the provision of advisory services, technical assistance, capacity building, and international cooperation with respect to preventing such violence and discrimination. This will be in support to the national efforts made by the member countries to combat such violence and discrimination against the persons. And the independent expert has been asked to report annually to the Human Rights Council. This resolution on the protection against violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation, gender identity, was voted by 47 states of Human Rights Council. Among these 47 countries, 23 countries voted in favor of resolution, 18 countries voted against the resolution, and 6 countries abstained from the resolution. India is also one of the 6 countries that abstained voting for this resolution. Abstaining means formally declining to vote. That is, they will neither vote in favor of the resolution nor they will vote against a resolution. So this is India's stand with respect to the recent resolution. Now, India declining from voting for this resolution has attracted criticism from human rights activists and human rights defenders. Now, this is because this resolution has come after the Supreme Court has struck down the part of Section 377 of Indian Penal Code that was used to criminalize the people belonging to sexual minorities. They are criticizing that even after the declaration of Supreme Court or the judgment of Supreme Court that has told the Section 377 cannot be used on sexual minorities for consensual adult sexual relationship, the central government has not voted in favor of the resolution to protect all persons against the violence and discrimination. Prior to the Supreme Court verdict with respect to Section 377, the particular section in Indian Penal Code penalized and criminalized the individuals with homosexual orientation in India in the name of unnatural offenses. And with respect to abstention, this is not the first time for India to abstain from voting for such resolutions that are adopted to protect the persons against such violence and discrimination. Even in 2016, India has abstained from voting on the appointment of independent expert to protect persons against such violence and discrimination. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. With this, we come to the analysis of next news article. This article is about digitization of manuscripts. The analysis of this article is relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and also in history of India. The discussion can also be linked to main syllabus in GS paper 1 in the area salient aspects of Indian literature. The article states that the Oriental Research Institute or ORI has taken steps for digitization of its collection. It has nearly 70,000 palm leaf manuscripts and paper manuscripts in Sanskrit and Kannada. When we say manuscript, we mean a book or a document or even a piece of music that is written by hand rather than in a typed or printed form. It is said that it may take about 2 to 3 years for the entire collection that is available in Oriental Research Institute to be digitized. The Oriental Research Institute is a collection or a repository of 40,000 palm leaf manuscripts. See, the palm leaf manuscript is one of the oldest medium of writing in India, especially in southern India. The palm leaf manuscripts are manuscripts that are made out of dried palm leaves. They were written in ink on a rectangular cut and cured palm leaf, as you can see in the news article. Each leaf sheet has a hole through which a string can pass through, and with the help of it, the sheets are tied together to bind it like a book. Therefore, a palm leaf text would typically last for a few decades, and it will take about 600 years before it completely decays. The Oriental Research Institute consists of, or it enshrines or embodies, the ancient Indian knowledge system. It covers different disciplines, and one of the objectives or the aim of this institute is to collect, preserve, collate, edit, and publish rare and valuable Sanskrit and Kannada palm leaf as well as paper manuscripts of our country. Manuscripts are nothing but manual scripts. These collections are part of India's heritage. Hence, it adds to the understanding of our history, and also it throws light on various aspects of art, culture, and literature. It was established, that is, the Oriental Research Institute was established in 1891 under the University of Mysore. Now, you may think why we are discussing an institute which is not a national institute. Now, it is because the institute preserves one of the important manuscripts of Indian history, and that is Kautilya's Arthashastra. Now, Arthashastra is a book that is written by Kautilya, who is also known as Chanakya. It is a work on Indian polity, economics, military science, business management, administration, civil law, and governance. It also mentions about gemology and metallurgy. When we say gemology, it means the study of precious stones, and metallurgy is the branch of science and technology that is concerned with the properties of metals and their production and purification. If you see Arthashastra, you can also find the depictions of training of elephants, horses for warfare, and it also describes taxation policy. Some experts say that it very clearly elaborates the taxation policy that has to be adopted in a country. This Oriental Research Institute has the oldest extant or the oldest existing copy of Kautilya's Arthashastra. It has a complete palm leaf manuscript of Arthashastra of Kautilya in Grantha script. Grantha is the name applied to the script that was used in Tamil Nadu for writing the Sanskrit language. The word Grantha denotes a literary work in Sanskrit. This palm leaf manuscript of Arthashastra of Kautilya was discovered and edited for the first time by Dr. R. Shyamasastri, who is a well-known scholar and librarian of this Oriental Research Institute. And in 1909, for the first time in the world, this work was published. And the publication of the work brought the work of Kautilya to the public domain. And this publication actually brought international acclamation and recognition to this Oriental Research Institute. Now, the key factor that is driving the digitization exercise was that the palm leaf manuscripts and paper manuscripts are susceptible to deterioration and degradation over the number of years. So in a course of time, they might become extinct or be lost for the future generations if it is not preserved. So if it is not preserved properly, it may become extinct or it may not be available for the future generations. In addition to this, they are saying that frequent handling of manuscripts by scholars and the exposure to the light and heat, these are some of the factors that contributed to the deterioration of these manuscripts. And because of many years, the manuscripts could also suffer discoloration and or it can get affected by fungus, termites, etc. These are some of the reasons why they are carrying out this digitization exercise of manuscripts available in the Oriental Research Institute. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. Now let us move on to the final session of practice questions discussion. First question, in which of the following missions was the moon impact probe carried out? So the answer for this question is option B, Chandrayaan 1. Chandrayaan 1 actually carried out a moon impact probe that hit or made an impact on the lunar surface closer to lunar south pole. So it's not Chandrayaan 2. The option C is talking about the recent mission of Israel, one of the private mission that was launched with an aim to soft land on moon's surface but failed. So the option D, Mangalyaan, is the Indian mission to Mars that was launched in the year 2014. And the correct answer is option B, Chandrayaan 1. We know that Chandrayaan 2 aims to achieve soft landing on moon's surface, particularly in the location where no other country in the world has till now conducted soft landing, in the lunar south pole. And note that the Mars Orbiter Mission or the Mangalyaan has been awarded Space Pioneer Award for the category of Science and Engineering for the year 2015 by the US-based National Space Society. The next question, consider the following statements. They have given two statements and are asking which of the given statements are correct. First statement, the legislature of Union Territory of Puducherry has wider powers in enacting laws in comparison with legislature of National Capital Territory of Delhi. We know that this statement is correct because the Union Territory of Delhi or the National Capital Territory of Delhi cannot enact laws in the subjects of police, public order and in land according to Article 239 AA of Indian Constitution, whereas there is no such restriction for the legislature of Union Territory of Puducherry. The second statement, Section 18 of Government of Union Territories Act of 1963 allows the Legislative Assembly of Union Territory to make laws with respect to any of the matters enumerated in state list or concurrent list in the 7th schedule to the Indian Constitution. This statement is correct. So the correct answer for this question is option C, both 1 and 2. The term anthrax recently seen in news is related to which among the following? Is it a vaccine? Is it an explosive material? It's a sweetening agent, or is it a zoonotic disease? We saw that anthrax is also being used as a biological warfare agent. That doesn't mean it's a explosive material. So the correct answer for this question is option D, zoonotic disease. Anthrax is a zoonotic disease that can transmit from herbivore mammals to human beings. And we saw that there are three types. That is pulmonary anthrax, cutaneous anthrax or skin anthrax. And finally, we also saw about gastrointestinal anthrax during our analysis. So the correct answer for this question is option D, zoonotic disease. This question is also with reference to anthrax. They have given three statements and are asking which of the above statements are correct. The first statement says it is a neglected zoonotic disease. The term neglected here is conveying the meaning that these diseases affect mainly the poor and marginalized populations, particularly in low resource settings. And zoonotic means those infections or diseases that can be transferred from animals to humans. We saw that anthrax is a zoonotic disease. And yes, it is a neglected disease, and neglected zoonotic disease are a subset of neglected tropical diseases. The first statement is correct. So that means option D can be eliminated. The second statement says it is also known as ragpicker's disease. So this statement is also correct, because we saw that anthrax is also called as malignant pustule, malignant edema, wool sorter's disease, and also some documents also refer this disease as ragpicker's disease. The second statement is correct, and the third statement, it can be prevented by the vaccine Bacil Calmette Guerin. Now this statement is wrong, because this particular vaccine is a vaccine for tuberculosis and not for anthrax. So the statements 1 and 2 are correct. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1 and 2 only. This question is with reference to United Nations Human Rights Council. In the first statement, they have given two statements and are asking which among the above statements are not correct. So the first statement, it is responsible for strengthening the promotion and protection of human rights around the globe. We know that this statement is correct, and that is one of the main purpose of existence of this Human Rights Council of United Nations. Since this statement is correct and they are asking which of the statements are not correct, the statement 1 should not be in the answer. And the second statement, India was elected as a member country from January 2019 for a term of 3 years. This statement is correct, because we saw that the council is made up of 47 member states including India. That is from January 2019 for a term of 3 years. The council's membership is actually based on equitable geographical distribution with respect to 5 areas. They are African states, Asia Pacific states, Latin American and Caribbean states, Western European and other states, and Eastern European states. If you take African states and Asia Pacific states, totally 26 seats. 13 seats for African, 13 for Asia Pacific. And 8 seats goes for Latin American and Caribbean states, 7 for Western European and other states, 6 for Eastern European states. And India was elected as a member country from Jan 2019 for a term of 3 years in this Human Rights Council. So the second statement is also correct. And India was elected last year in the month of October 2018. So both the statements are correct. So the correct answer for this question is not both 1 and 2, but neither 1 nor 2. Option D is the correct answer.
With this, we come to the end of our today's news analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates and content on civil services preparation.